This session is focused on a topic which has been kind of one of much debate over the last kind of few years, and I think we've reached an inflection point with it, whereby it's now become much more real. It's gone from being an analyst theoretical future vision to something that's become far more tangible. So I'm very, very pleased to welcome to the stage Johannes Birze from Siemens, who are building their own Internet of Things platform. And Johannes has got a great, great story in terms of the journey that they're going on with some great advice and some great insight. So please welcome Johannes, who's flown in from Germany.
So thank you. It's really a great pleasure for me to be here. It's not a quite normal topic we discuss today, but I think it's an interesting one. Just a few words to the background. When you look on this term IoT, Internet of Things, then it's pretty much clear that Siemens, my company, comes more from this T, from the things. This I for Internet or cloud is becoming more and more very important. That is also clear. But our basic foundation is the T, are the things. And when we are talking about things, then we are talking about devices like PLCs, drives, motion controllers, but also SCADA systems or MES systems or HMI systems. And when you look in the area of power generation and distribution, we are talking about gas turbines, power switches, or e-meters. So these are the things we are coming from. And that's the reason why I want to talk about an industrial IoT platform, no? Not an IoT platform for shoes or something like that. Okay. So I want to start this presentation with a discussion about the question, what is an industrial thing? What is it? And what are the participants in this game called industrial IoT? When we have understood that, we can discuss how we can build a platform for that and what are the challenges we have to address. But at first, let's start with the discussion, what is an industrial thing? And looking on that question from a high-level perspective, you can identify three aspects. The first aspect is, it could be something between an entire plant, for process automation or factory automation, for example, or it could be something like a single I/O point, and it could be something in between. And that means a lot. It means that you have to address the problem of a lot of hierarchy levels and that you have to address the situation that not only big data is the issue here, it could be also small data. It could be the whole range. The second aspect is that normally this term of thing in the industry area is related to something we call machine, whatever a machine again is. Yeah? A machine could be a very simple machine, for example, packaging of newspaper, very simple thing. It could be a very complex machine. Printing machine is much more complex. Or a gas turbine is really a complex thing. It could be anything. But nevertheless, if we talk about machines in this way, we talk about machines running in production, and we talk also about productivity. So productivity is the goal, not the Internet of Things. And the third aspect is that we have a lot of different, let me see, owner of these machines. We have the machine builder, we have the end customer, and we have a lot more. So if you look on that in more detail, we can write down some attributes, let me say in this way, of an industrial thing. Again, a thing could be, again, part of a thing. So this hierarchies is a very important aspect of industrial things. A thing can be a part of a thing, can be a part of a thing, and so on. But it's not only about hierarchies. A thing is also integrated in some semantic networks. It contributes to something. It belongs to something. It delivers data to something. So there are a lot of semantic relationships between things which we have to model. The data that is produced from this thing or things could be from a few bytes per hour to millions of bytes per hour. So it could be really everything. If you look on a single I/O point, which switches every minute, it's not a problem. If you measure vibration data, you have a lot more of data to handle. In the same situation, when we're talking about creation of a lot of data, we talk about things based on a hardware which is normally very cheap. So if you look on a very simple PLC controller, there is no standard operating system in it. There is no multi-core architecture in it. It's a very simple hardware, very specific, very cheap, but it produces tons of data. That is important to understand. And the most important thing to understand, talking about industrial things, is that an industrial thing which relates to a machine is something that lives very long. Not years, decades. So if you look, an example, on a machine tool in a production line of BMW, maybe it lives 30 years. That is a realistic time frame. And that is totally different to the time frames we know from the eye, from the internet, or from the cloud. So talking about an industrial IoT means talking about the clash of two innovation and life cycles. A life cycle of decades on the one side, on the thing side, and a life cycle of maybe hours or minutes of some microservices in the cloud. Important to understand. The stakeholders we have looking on these machines or needing views on the data are, on the one hand, the well-known machine builder view and the end customer view. But if you look in a shop floor environment, it's much more difficult. There you have the controller, you have the production guys, you have the quality guys, the maintenance guys, and all these departments have the need of having their own specific view on this machine, on the thing. So you have a lot of different views on one thing. Okay. The participants in this game of IoT are, on the one hand, well-known. We have the well-known machine builder, or here called service provider, and we have the end customer or operator of the machine, here called service consumer. The service provider is not only building a machine and selling it, he is also providing some services, or apps we call it today, which he provides and delivers to the end customers using a marketplace. But more and more, we are coming in the situation that these service providers or machine builder are needing the help of domain-specific app developers to develop specific services. That is coming more and more. And again, a marketplace is the technology-wise base for exchange of these applications. So we have the classical service providers, the classical service consumers, and we have the app developers in this game. Okay. Now we have understood who are the participants and what are the characteristics of an IoT, of an industrial thing. Now we can talk about how to build a platform for this IoT environment. And if you look in the internet, you find many sources for that. Everything is based on the thing level, on the things. These things or devices have to be managed. So you have some kind of device management layer. And device management in this case means something like software provisioning, or on and offboarding, or connecting the devices. And all these things have to be done and managed in a way that addresses the typical needs of a shop floor. It's not a good idea to do a software update of a device during production when this would lead to a downtime. Not a good idea. And based on this device management, you have, on the one hand, all the services you provide using APIs. These APIs then are used by applications to do some domain-specific things, so business-specific things. Based on this device management, you have also all this big data processing, where you do all the things you know, like data lake, ETL processes. There are tools available like NIME, Kafka, and you know all the stuff. And we provide, or an IoT system provides, the possibility to implement and to monitor and to operate all the business processes you need to make money. If you look on these four colored blocks, then you see that it's, again, very generic. It is not very industry-specific. It becomes more industry-specific when you look on this column called identity management. Normally, identity management means you have the classical things, users and roles, nothing special, yeah? If you look in the industry environment, these users and roles are industrial users and roles representing different customers you call tenants. And it's very important to understand that also a thing, a device, could be a user having a role assigned, having some permissions, needing some relations. So in this case, this block identity management has also an industry-specific touch. But really crucial for the success of an industrial IoT platform is the right column, which is called model management. What does it mean? If you want to analyze data, for example, you can do it best, I think, when you know a lot of the machine you want to analyze, when you know her relations, when you have a model of the machine, for example, or a model of your plant, or a model of whatever. So these models could be automation models, mechanical models, analytical models. But in any case, you have to manage it, and you should use it to get insights out of the data you collect. And the better the models are, the better the insights. We at Siemens, we implemented this structure. We call it MindSphere. We have used a three-layer approach like normal. We have a layer, it's called MindConnect. This is all the connectivity stuff with our own connectivity elements from Siemens. And we can also address all other connectivity elements using open standards. We have the backend itself, which provides a lot of interfaces, a lot of APIs, which then are used by these Mind apps. These apps are implemented by Siemens or by domain-specific partners or by third-party companies. The important thing here to understand is that the business model is a subscription-based or usage-based model. And usage means usage of data, which are in MindSphere or in your IoT framework or in your platform, and you use that to analyze some things. Okay, what are the challenges we have to address? The first challenge is very simply called, let me call it scalability. Scalability means that, for example, the number of devices which is connected to your cloud can vary very quickly, very rapidly. In the 1 second you have 1,000, in the next second you have 100,000. Also, the number of users is varying over time very rapidly. So you have to manage these in a very quickly appropriate way. And you have to manage that worldwide in any data center you provide. And that is the reason why we come or why we came to the conclusion that we use a software technology called Cloud Foundry. Cloud Foundry is a framework for the deployment and for the scaling of microservices, though we implemented the complete backend as microservices, following this 12-factor app approach. and in the case we need some persistency layer, we use that. It's not a problem to adapt or to connect a persistency technology to Cloud Foundry using service brokers. So we use that approach, and one advantage of this approach is also that independent of the data center we use or the infrastructure as a server provider we use, Cloud Foundry is the one environment that can be used by app developers to write apps against MindSphere or against this IoT system. There are other technologies today available to address this issue, but we decided for Cloud Foundry to manage our deployments and our scalability stuff. The next challenge is very simple, called collaboration. The point is, if you talk about data centers, for example, which we have to run and operate in different countries with different laws and different policies, then this is really complicated stuff. And we as Siemens, we are not the best in operating data centers. And it's not only about data centers, it's also about running all the infrastructure you need around. You need, for example, you need to operate and run your OpenStack environment, your Cloud Foundry environment. You have, for legacy applications, you have a lot of VMs, a lot of containers. Yeah? You have to operate your databases. And all these things are managed mostly by partners. So we collaborate with a lot of them the most important you see here. We started from historical reasons with SAP, but we also collaborate with Amazon Web Stores, Web Services, with Microsoft Asia, Accenture, Atos, IBM, and others. So it's important to know on what you have to focus from your business perspective, and all the other things, collaborate with partners. Good idea. The next challenge is called, or is also very simple to understand, you always have to monitor and to analyze the behavior of your system. Behavior may mean that everything is okay, but normally that is not the case. So you have the need to analyze bottlenecks, to analyze some specific events, to monitor that. And to do that not only on the level of a single microservice or a single application, you have to do that on the level of what AppDynamics calls business transactions. So you have end-to-end use cases. Data from a thing, for example, is coming in the system, is coming in the persistency layer. Or a user is logging in and wants to see some data in a fleet manager. Yeah? Or an administrator logs in and creates a new user. So you have to define this business transactions, and you have to do all the monitoring in the context of that. That is the important thing. For that, we decided to use AppDynamics. And from a, let me say, from a technical perspective, it was not a great thing to convince the management to do that. It was not a great thing because we decided to do some, we call it proof of concept together with the colleagues from AppDynamics. And this proof of concept was very simple. Let's use AppDynamics in the context of a realistic performance test. Maybe check 1-2 days the performance of our system, and let's see how AppDynamics can help us finding the bottlenecks. And that was the proof of concept, and it worked very well. So from a technical perspective, it was not a great deal. Management was convinced. Was really not a big deal. We could show that it helps really a lot. We could prove that deep dives are possible. We could prove that baselining is possible. So from a technical perspective, it was not a great deal to convince the management to use that. Yeah, the next challenge, how to manage and monitor this so-called IoT, industrial IoT platform. And here I think it's important to understand that managing and monitoring of an IoT system is nothing you can do on your own completely. We learned that managing and monitoring of such a system means to focus on the managing and monitoring and operating of the parts you really need to manage your business cases. For example, and that leads to the conclusion that we focus on so-called, we call it control points. We want to control, for example, our connectivity layer or the endpoints of the connectivity in our system. That is very clear, very important for us as Siemens. Yeah, we want to control the identity and access management because devices could also be users. It's very important for us. We want to control and manage the so-called IoT models, or the model and the persistency layer, which represents the things and the relations between them. That is also something we want to control. We want to control our APIs we provide for our users and other app developers. Yeah, that is also a control point from our perspective. And we want to control the marketplace, because marketplace means making money, very simple. So these control points are subject to managing, operating, and monitoring an industrial IoT system. For all the other things, managing a data center, managing OpenStack, Cloud Foundry, all these infrastructural things, we use partners. I think that the control points listed here are very typical for the industrial environment. They are not Siemens specific. I'm convinced. You can discuss whether something is missing, or maybe you feel some point is not sufficient. But in general, I think this is very typical for the industrial environment. Industrial in the sense or like I told you, when we talk about process automation, factory automation, or power generation and power distribution. So in the end, my recommendation for you, when you are also willing to think about an industrial IoT platform or environment, cloud-based, maybe hybrid, private, or something like that, is really to define and to implement and to focus on these so-called control points. And these control points are reflecting normally your business model. So first think about a business model, then you would identify your control points, and please only operate, manage, and monitor this. For the rest, you can use partners available all around the world. Very typical for the industry environment is that the connectivity layer or the control of the endpoints of the connectivity is a control point, so take care of that. It's a good idea to integrate all this stuff in own devices or connectivity elements if you have something, so you have a unique selling point in the hand. And manage your APIs, do it explicitly, because the modern software business is not longer only a software business, it's API business. Yeah, you charge the usage of APIs normally. That means you have to measure it, and you have to use this knowledge as a base for your business model. Okay, doing that, I'm sure you will come to a high innovation speed in your system, and that is important, and to high quality. Okay, that was a very rough overview about that question, what an industrial IoT may mean. Questions?
Any questions, anyone? I think there's quite a lot of topics that Johannes has covered here, from, you know, the fact that, oh, we've got one there? Good question. Yes.
Oh, yeah.
With Internet of Devices, and I guess they will be lasting like 30 years or so, how do you think that like security comes into play with that? Because I guess there's things like SuxNet that have like taken over devices, and I guess there's smart TVs which can kind of be hacked and you can be listened to. Is there a way for detecting devices which have been compromised or securing devices, do you think?
Talking about security in the context of a 30-year-old device, it's a challenge. That's clear, because 30 years ago there was no security. Yeah. And normally you can do different things. One possible solution is that you connect these, let me say, unsecure devices to the internet or to the cloud using some kind of security gateway. You need something between that. And that is the case not only because these devices are very old, there are also, I think, devices which are so weak that they are not able to handle, for example, certificates or cryptographic things. That is not possible, though handling these devices also means to provide the possibility of using something like a security gateway in between. But nevertheless, it's a difficult story. Yeah.
Any other questions? Johannes talked about data volumes as a topic, connectivity, and also focusing on your core competencies as a business. Mm-hmm. Any questions around those topics or any others? Or any other questions there relating to IoT adoption? We have one more. Okay, just to the back there. I want the next question to be over there, so we keep everyone moving around. It's good. Thank you.
Yeah, just do you have an example of where latency is really important in these sort of industrial IoT applications, and how you measure it and improve it?
Latency depends on the use case you have. As soon as we as long as we talk about use cases coming from this analytical world where you collect data and analyze it days after, there is no reason why latency should be a problem. Latency comes into the game when you not only want to analyze, but you also want to control some things, so you write things down. Then latency comes into the game. And here you see the typical requirements coming also from SCADA or HMI systems, which means you should guarantee a latency of a few seconds or something like that, half a second, second, 1, 2, 3, 4 seconds. Then you have to do special measures to guarantee that. Yeah. Okay. But nevertheless, if you're talking about cloud, we are never talking about real time. Yeah, if you come from the real-time area where we talk about microseconds, there's a different world. If you want to do some analytical stuff in this world, you have to do it on the device. And that again means looking on an IoT platform that you should be able to provide analytical things on different levels, on the device level, maybe on some gateway level, and maybe on the cloud level. There's no way around that.
Any more questions at all around adoption or kind of more general questions in terms of Johannes' experience in terms of driving an IoT platform, going beyond Siemens, or general observations? Any more questions, anyone? Sure, no one over there, no, for example. Sorry? Okay, one more. Just 1 second. You're getting a pincer movement. You're getting microphones from both sides. Okay.
One is fairly enough. Did you have any issues storing big data off-premise, or did you do that, especially in looking on personal data from customers?
Good point. Actually, we do only public cloud. Yeah, we store all the data in a public cloud, and we spend a lot of effort to securely separate the data between the tenants. Yeah, the separation has a lot of consequences, but you have to do that because it's not a good idea to enable BMW to see the data of Daimler, for example. Really not a good idea. So we do a lot of effort, we spend a lot of effort for that, but it's normally solved on top of the persistence level, using rights, roles, and all these concepts to access data. So for example, a customer or a tenant is something, also something which has roles and rights and scopes and all the stuff. It's done on this level, not in the persistence level itself.
Is that a question that comes up very often in terms of the data security? Because living in Germany, like Johannes, is quite a big topic.
Yeah, it's a question that is very normal because from looking in the history of all these customers, for example, automotive, it's very clear that they are very sensitive about their quality data, for example. They want to collect using the system. Quality data means you can analyze what is the weakness, not only the strengths, what is the weakness of your production, of your machine, of your business strategy. And so again and again, there are discussions between us and these customers about on-premise solutions, for example. It's clear that at beginning at some point in this discussion, you have to provide something like an on-premise solution, but you can also observe that it becomes more and more accepted that secure handling of data and secure handling of tenant and customer separation in a public cloud is usable, it works. There's more and more confidence in that. But I think it's a question of time also. If you think back, if you look on your personal bank accounts, I think 10 years before, it was not very accepted that your personal data are in the cloud or in the public cloud solution of your bank. Now, today, you are not thinking about that. It's okay. I mean, it works. And the same process you can observe in the world of industry.
Great. Any more questions related to cloud, for example, cloud adoption, and obviously the selection of Cloud Foundry? Any other questions around on the cloud side at all? Any more? Okay. Well, thanks very much. Please, hand for Johannes. Thank you. Thank you, everyone.